A grand civilization with the widest possible spread. For over 2,000 years, the Harappan civilization flourished, creating the greatest cities of its time. Yet, we know so little about it. Dr. Vasant Shinde, the Vice Chancellor of the Deccan College of Archaeology in Pune, has spent over 40 years excavating India's Bronze Age sites. There isn't a site across the vast Harappan universe that he hasn't been to. So given that anything about the Harappans, from where they came from to where they went, is fodder for national debates, we decided to sit down and ask the expert what the latest research was pointing towards.
Now we use two terms now. One is the one term that we use called Harappan culture. And that culture has existed from the recent data from the Ghaggar Basin. It goes back to 5500 BC. So from 5500 BC up to the end of the Harappan civilization, that is up to 1500 BC. So this is a long phase of the Harappan culture, for more than 4000 years. So, and there is one phase of this Harappan culture which developed into civilization, or the urban phase. So that phase we call as the Harappan civilization, and that is from 2600 BC to 2000 BC, and after 2000 BC again the decline starts. So now it is clear that, you know, the Harappan, there is a proper, you know, we can identify the cultural process, that there is a formative stage, very long phase, from 5500 BC to 2600 BC, almost for 2000 or more than 2000 years. So they were developing in fact, and the data that we have from some of the early sites, that the Harappans began their lifestyle very modestly. Mm-hmm. They started living in small circular huts, they started developing ceramics, they started developing, you know, most of the other crafts, and there is a gradual growth, and most of the traditions, most of the basic technologies, they were perfected during the Harappan civilization. Maybe around 2600 BC.
I remember once you were misquoted as saying that Harappa is older than Mesopotamia. And I think the reporter didn't get the context in which you spoke about the culture versus the civilization. There is another very big obsession, which is who were the Harappans? You know, DNA tests have been done. A lot of work has been done on genetics, etc. What do we know about the Harappans as a people?
See, when we talk about Harappans, we cannot confined only to the Harappan period only. But we need also to find out what was happening before the Harappans. And in the Indian subcontinent, the beginning of settled life is very important. And we have some of the earliest evidence of settled life in the region, you know, where the Harappan culture flourished. The site of Mehrgarh particularly, which is in Pakistan, in the Bolan Pass. Now that site is very crucial to understand the growth of the, or the emergence of the Harappan culture. So the French team in fact has excavated that site on, you know, very detailed impact excavation was done, and they worked at the site for almost 13 to 14 years, and that site has a complete cultural sequence of the phase, you know, for which, you know, we use the term proto-history. So right from the beginning till the Harappan, you know, elements. And what we are getting in fact, you know, that the Harappan elements were not introduced suddenly. At every stage, in fact, you know, there are seven different stages of development. At every stage, we see one Harappan element introduced.
Really?
Yes.
So, what is the sequence?
In the earliest stage, you know, we have some terracotta figurines, human figurines. They are very stylistic and very simple. In the next stage, you know, it, you know, gets the form of human. Then there is a decoration, and when it comes to the Harappan period, it is fully evolved.
Where is the kernel of the Harappan civilization, the Indus Valley civilization? Which is the area you think which has the deepest phase of organized or urban settlement?
We have enough data in fact to talk about this. Earlier it was thought that maybe Sindh region was the nuclear zone of the Harappan civilization, Harappan culture and Harappan civilization. Everybody thought that, you know, that origin took place here, and then they dispersed to other regions. Because, you know, in the initial stage, you know, we did not have much data beyond the Indus region. Now we have a lot of data now outside the Indus region. We have a lot of sites in the Saraswati Basin or the, you know, Ghaggar Hakra. In fact, Ghaggar Hakra region was much more important for the Harappans than the Indus region, because nearly two-thirds sites are located in that region.
And the bigger cities are located.
And the bigger cities also are located there. Then, you know, we have excavated number of sites here. Now, the dates are going back to almost 5500 BC in all the regions. That indicates that the development was happening almost more or less simultaneously, and they were growing simultaneously more or less.
Mm.
So it is not that, you know, that there is a one nuclear zone and from there, you know, people have spread, not like that. In the Harappan region, in fact, you know, that development has happened simultaneously, and right from beginning they were in touch with each other, and therefore, you know, maybe you can find a lot of the Harappan elements in the Ghaggar Basin, the Harappan, you know, in the Harappan region of you know, Indus, and vice versa. So that was happening. So this was something like, you know, very, very, you know, dynamic, you know, process that was happening.
And over a long period of time, nearly 4,000 years.
Yes,
I mean, that's what you're looking at,
yes,
you know.
Sir, exactly.
But my question is that, again, people are obsessed with the genetics. So I'm going to come to that. If you see the spread all the way from the edge of Afghanistan,
yes,
to perhaps the northern part of Maharashtra,
yes,
that was the spread of the Harappan civilization.
Right, right.
What were the people like? Because there was constant motion between the different areas. So how can we be certain that these were indigenous people or outsiders? What is your own assessment?
See, my own assessment is that it is the indigenous people who have developed this. So when we talk about the, you know, the people, Harappan people, or the composition of the Harappan people, then we need to consider two important, you know, evidence. One is the archaeological evidence and the other one is the genetic evidence. As far as the archaeological evidence is concerned, now it clearly demolishes the earlier hypothesis that people came from outside, maybe from Persian Gulf region or from Mesopotamia, because had the people come from there, they would have brought the, you know, cultural elements from that region and introduced here, which is not happening in fact. On the other hand, you know, the site of Mergad has a very good evidence about the gradual development of the culture. And secondly, you know, in terms of the genetic data, now we have some data now. And also we have now data from the site of Rakhigadi. Now that also indicates that there is no migration of the people, you know, for last 10,000 years. People have not come on in a very large number in from outside and settle here, nor vice versa.
Mm.
So that is very, very, you know, very important. And the, you know, we are yet to publish, you know, the data that from the site of Rakhigadi, you know, where we have extracted DNA. So there is some hint that, you know, that it is the local people who were constantly doing that, developing. And because they was, you know, maybe agriculture communities, they had a lot of, you know, maybe requirements. So because of that, you know, they have gone even beyond the Indian subcontinent for to get maybe some necessary
resources,
raw materials, resources. So because of that, you know, and people from that region also were coming here. So right from the beginning, there is a lot of, you know, interaction between different regions. And then, you know, people were moving. But now I separate, you know, migration from the movement. Movement is different, you know, because some few people were coming here, few people were going there, like, you know, what we are doing today. So that was happening, and because of
that was continuous.
That was continuous.
The results of the DNA test from Rakhigadi are awaited. Meanwhile, there is a lot else we should focus on. Dr. Shinde has just published his latest book on the knowledge system of the Harappans.
So we one very important contribution that Harappans were the best civil engineers.
Hmm.
Because they have introduced the most scientific construction method which is being followed even today. There is no alternative to that even today. And today that method is called English bond. You know, when we construct a wall of maybe bricks, one layer of the brick is kept horizontal, the next is vertical. Like that, you know, we do that. So that is called the English bond method. And that was the first earliest evidence of that goes back to the Harappan times. The English people were not really aware till 1480. So we still, you know, call that as English bond because people are not really aware that, you know, that this was there in fact before and it was introduced by the Harappans. And the other contribution that I will mention, and I will, you know, tell you that, you know, all of you should visit that site, the site of Dholavira. And that site has the best evidence of water harvesting and water management in the world. Even today there is no parallel for that.
Mm.
You know, that city was established in a region, you know, which was dry. Even that time also, during the Harappan times, the climate was not much different. Maybe slightly higher rainfall. But still there was always dearth of water there that time also. So they plan a city in Paris in such a way that it is in between two small rivers. And then, you know, in this region, you know, there is occasional rainfall. In the desert part, there is occasional rainfall.
Sure.
And there is, you know, whenever there is maybe slightly higher rainfall, there is flash floods coming to these, you know, streams or the rivers. What the Harappans did in Paris, you know, they dam these both the rivers. There are series of dams in Paris. And those dams are on the, you know, this on the, you know, gradient in fact, you know, from higher level to lower level. Series of dams. There is evidence for that. Actual physical evidence is there. And they have diverted the entire water inside the settlement. See the, you know, arrangement that these people made. And then, you know, in the city is divided into three parts, the Dholavira. And in each part, they excavated number of underground water tanks, huge tanks. And those tanks were connected by underground water channel system, so that, you know, they, you know, the all the tanks get filled in fact, you know, one after other. So that is how, you know, they made sure that there is always, you know, flowing water inside the settlement, and they never failed the scarcity of water. Now my suggestion in fact, you know, I have been, you know, discussing about this, you know, quite frequently, and my suggestion to the planners that, you know, adopt this model in fact for the entire Kutch. Because Kutch is facing the severe water scarcity.
Professor Shinde, what was the innovation in everyday life that we know of?
In fact, in each aspect, you can see that in fact. For example, you know, the houses that were built by the Harappans. In each region, because they had occupied different ecological zones, and the requirement was different in fact of the, you know, these different ecological zones of the housing pattern. Now, I have been working in Haryana, which has got extreme climatic condition. The, you know, summer is extreme and winter is extreme. Now, what the Harappans have done, in fact, you know, they develop a plan, you know, where, you know, you will get sufficient light and ventilation. It is open, in fact, in the middle, it is open courtyard, and the structures of the rooms are located on all sides. So, there is, you know, enough light and ventilation, you know, going to all these. So that is in a very, you know, scientific plan these people.
Which is continued even today.
Yes.
In our houses across
yes,
the country.
Yes, exactly. Secondly, you know, a lot of crafts, you know, like, they also introduced, you know, this tandoor. The earliest evidence of tandoor goes back to 3000 BC. And, you know, we have at number of sites. And that tandoor is exactly, if you see, you know, see the modern tandoor and the Harappan tandoor, it looks so similar. So there is a continuity in that also. Tandoor chicken, in fact, I always say that tandoor chicken is the delicacy which was introduced by the Harappans. And that continues.
That's a new way of looking at the tandoori chicken.
No, but we have evidence, in fact. We have tandoor, in fact, at the site of Kalibanga.
Huh.
And at the same time, you know, in that site, we have the, you know, physical remains of the chicken.
Bones.
We have the chicken bones, which
wow.
have got charring marks. We always say that, you know, this tandoor chicken was the Harappan delicacy. And you know how much it is popular in fact in that, you know, and almost all of
we the also know about the food of the Harappans, right?
Yes,
because
yes.
some evidence has been found of you using turmeric, for
turmeric,
instance.
Turmeric, yeah.
What is the evidence?
No, turmeric is there, of course. You know, we do not have much, you know. And then, you know, we have also found the traces of the, you know, this brinjal. But now we are working on this, you know, because we need to, you know, generate more data.
You know,
so certainly, you know, that, you know, the concept of, you know, the Indian curry in fact, you know, was started from the Harappan times.
So from houses to curry to tandoori chicken, there has been a continuum from Harappan times. Latest excavations have also thrown up other connections.
Religion, we don't know much about that because, you know, we are not getting those big, you know, these religious structures. If at all the Harappans practice religion, maybe it was more prior, you know, personal rather. And at some places, you know, we are getting those icons, you know, which have been identified as, you know, lingas.
Lingas,
right? Yes. And there are some.
So there is some kind of proto-Shiva,
yeah, yeah.
because there is a concept
yeah,
of Pashupati,
no, linga,
for example.
Linga is a proper Shiva, but there are also some horn deity figurines, horn human figurines wearing horn headdress. So that is also there, in fact. And, you know, it is always considered that, you know, this is called the Pashupati. And Pashupati, or the Lord of Beast, is considered the early form of Shiva. So there is a proper, maybe, you know, the early form of Shiva, and
so
also
you are
Shiva.
you're seeing it in a discernible
yeah, yeah.
way.
At the site of Padri in fact, you know, which I excavated in Gujarat, we have found a big jar in fact, you know, which is there in our library, you know, museum. And there is a human figure, you know, standing human figure painted on that, with a huge horned headdress, and that figure is moving. So that, and even at Kalibanga also, at number of sites we have that.
You know, the other big obsession in India is what happened to the Harappans, okay? And I'm going to ask you two buckets of questions in there. The first is, all Bronze Age civilizations collapse around the same time, because there is now a lot of research that shows that there was a cataclysmic natural calamity,
yes,
that led to de-urbanization, because many of these trade networked civilizations collapsed. What is the research that you've done found?
Now, the research that we have done, because now I have worked on this particular aspect quite extensively, and also, you know, some Japanese and Koreans also collaborating, you know, with me on this particular issue. Now, we have generated some data on climate. Now, I have done that, and some earlier scholars have also done that. Now, when you look at the sequence, climatic sequence, around 2000 BC or maybe 4000 BP, the climate has gone dry suddenly. And we initially we thought that maybe this is a local phenomenon, maybe in that northwest part of the Indian subcontinent. But then, you know, we have data from other parts of the world. We have a lot of data from China, from Sichuan province, from Mongolia, also some data from, you know, European countries, from West Asia, and also from India. And all the data indicates that around 2000 BC the climate was going dry. And that is now established that climate was the main villain impact for the decline of the most of the civilizations, not only Harappan civilization. The Mesopotamian collapsed at the same time, the, you know, Egyptians collapsed at the same time.
The Minoans, the Mycenaeans.
So this was, you know, a dry phase was prevailing almost all over the world. But, you know, what happens in fact in the Harappan region, those civilizations, you know, they cease to be, they just stop. But the Harappans continued their lifestyle in fact up to 1500 BC. In spite of the climate becoming dry. So this evidence is there in fact strong. And then, you know, we can see the consequence of this climate, you know, change on various aspects. For example, you know, this Saraswati River goes dry around 2000 BC. Now, we do not have a date for this event, but we can use archaeological data for understanding this particular event, when this particular event has happened. Because we have large number of sites of the early phase and also the mature phase up to 2000 BC. They are all found along the river banks. And suddenly after 2000 BC, the rivers, the settlements are going away from the river banks. So that indicates perhaps the river maybe, you know, was not that significant. Secondly, you know, they carried out a very flourishing trade with the West, and they used a lot of sea routes also.
Sure.
So they established number of ports along the Makran coast and also the Saurashtra coast. The sea level has gone dry, you know, down around 2000 BC, and this is scientifically established. You know, one of the geologists, Professor Meher from MS University Baroda, geologist. Now he collected data and he established that consequence of the climatic change, the sea level has gone down. So a lot of ports, you know, which were developed by the Harappans on the Makran coast and the Saurashtra coast, now they became inland sites. So naturally there was immense impact on the flourishing trade, in fact, the Harappans had. And because of the trade, you know, Harappans, you know, were, you know, flourishing, in fact. So that evidence is, you know, very much there. And then, you know, it appears that, you know, they lost the agriculture base, because the Indus plain and the, you know, Saraswati plain, they were the most important agricultural bases for the Harappans. So we find that, you know, Harappans are moving away from that part. And, you know, when you look at the scenario in fact during the, you know, Harappan times, it is not that only Harappans flourished in fact. The entire Indian subcontinent was inhabited. And there were a number of, you know, early farming communities around the Harappans.
So you're saying that when this natural calamity happened, they just simply moved away and merged into these communities.
And there they kept alive the Harappan tradition and the Harappan technology till, you know, that is how it continues.
Okay. So the other obsession, of course, is on this whole Aryan, Vedic, Sanskrit speaking tribe that comes in.
Yes, yes.
Now the thing is, because the Harappan script has not been deciphered, we don't know very little about this intermingling of these two communities, because obviously the Vedic script was there, the Sanskrit script was there. So what is your own assessment of what really happened in that time? I mean, was it gradual? What is the latest research showing up there?
know, the latest research that there is also attempt to find out whether the Vedic people were the same, whether the Harappan people same, where they were the Harappan people. And according to me, in fact, that I don't really find a separate, Vedic culture as such.
No?
No.
But what about the Sanskrit?
There is a mention about, various things. Like, there's a mention about in Rigveda, there's, 100 times, the river Saraswati is mentioned. And there are, maybe flourishing cities on the bank of river Saraswati. So if you look at the archaeological data, we do not have cities of the earlier period and cities of the later period also. There are only Harappan, settlements there. And the biggest Harappan city is located in that part. So if you want to relate the archaeological data with the literary sources, then it is this particular, we can relate the Harappan settlements with the description there. There is also mention about, the, ideal, city divided into three parts. The only evidence of that comes from the site of Dholavira. We don't have that kind of evidence in the early, historical period or in the medieval also. So maybe, we can try to understand that. There's also, mention about, the fire worship, in fact. And, the sites located in that part, like Kalibanga, for example, or Rakhigadi. Now, only these sites are producing the evidence of
fire worship.
There are altars, in fact, and they are not simple, domestic, hearths, in fact. They are much, maybe beyond that. And at Kalibanga, there's a properly made, in fact, fire altar, which is lined with bricks. And inside there is an in situ evidence of the animal, charred animal bones.
But tell me something, part of the whole Vedic theory was the movement of one branch to Persia, one branch down south, the connection between Vedic and Zoroastrianism, for example, at one particular era. How do you justify that?
So, see, there is a movement, in fact, of people. There is a contact with all these different regions right from the beginning. So, whether you call this as a maybe migration or movement, these are the two different words now we should be careful about. We don't really see migration of the people, in fact. There is always movement, in fact, from, because they were, all the different settlements were interdependent, interconnected. So they were constantly moving, in fact, from this region. And if you analyze the settlements of the Harappan period, there are only 5 cities out of 2,000 settlements that we talk. There are only 5 cities. And the other settlements are in different categories. There are large number of villages, large number of these pastoral camps. So that type of pastoral, this type of symbiotic relation existed. So we we have that preconceived notion, in fact, that there was only one pastoral community and agricultural community. But they were in fact part of the same this
so
system.
How do you justify the fact that the epics or the Vedic texts, the early Vedic texts, don't have a reference to Dholavira and the Lothal area, and it's all centered around the north? What is your analysis of that, if this is a theory where there was constant movement?
See, because that region was more vibrant, in fact, because most of the trade routes are located in that part. From between Harappa and Mohenjo-daro, there was a main trade route between Harappa and Mohenjo-daro. And there was also a lot of movement, in fact, beyond Harappa, towards north. So people from the Central Asia, from Iran, in fact, they were interacting, with that region. So therefore, we find more, in fact, so that region is more, focused in the past also. So maybe, they may not have mentioned about, each and every
settlement. Absence of any information, any reference, I mean, that's a little.
There are a lot of issues, when that particular text was written, we do not know really whether, does it really not talk about, the early settlements, or it was later, written much later.
Remains a grey area.
This remains a grey area, but I think, we are working on that.
Dr. Shinde's belief that what we have been calling the early Vedic culture may have been symbiotic with the existing Harappan civilization throws up many questions, and a lot more work needs to be done to help answer these. Meanwhile, there remain two great challenges as we try and lift the veil on the Harappans: the script that is yet to be deciphered, and the sites themselves, which are dwindling. In 1964, a survey of the Ghaggar Basin had thrown up 450 sites from the Harappan period. In 2006, a survey conducted under Dr. Shinde showed that there were just a dozen left. The rest have sadly just disappeared as farms and towns have taken over. Forget not being able to know more, we face the threat of losing what we have on our great Harappan civilization.